to another episode of the Miles Offside Podcast, where we talk a little bit of football and a whole lot of nonsense. My name is Oscar Puente, also known as Footy From Afar, and with me, as always, are my co-hosts, Mr. FPL Champion Chuck Bailey and Super Producer Ian Stimson. Chuck, welcome to your 30s, bud. First time recording. How you feeling?
I was trying to keep up positivity for this year, but it's not really working very good.
Well, what about Palace? Palace has got to be you know, they played on your birthday, right? Was that...
Fuck off. Don't like it.
Well, kept Arsenal to a draw. I mean, it was the dullest game in history, but...
Until United and Liverpool this morning. Jesus.
Oh, God, yeah.
Oh, the biggest game in world football. Sky Sports.
It's grimly inevitable whenever they promo anything that hard, isn't it?
It's so boring. There's been, like... two games in the last 5 years that's had more than two goals in that game. Like, shut up, you knobheads. No one cares. It's depressing because it's like, is that actually the biggest derby in this country? Like, is that the British Classico? Like, is it?
From the outside in, I would say absolutely. Yeah, to us, that's what we would consider like the biggest. And like, I don't have any, fuck the history, obviously. Like, fuck all the little ass clubs that won something in the 80s and are like, we're great European champions. Oh my God, best in the world. Like, no, fuck you. But Liverpool United does feel like it has an occasion. It does feel like a big, big fixture to me, at least as the American. I don't know. How do you not think it's like your biggest?
Well, no, that's what I mean. That's why, like, I don't know whether it's because we just have so many more teams and so many more derbies, but it's like, in Spain, you get Barca Real, the El Clasico. In Germany, you get Der Klassiker between Munich and Dortmund. You get like the Derby d'Italia, or whatever, and then we just get like United Liverpool. You know what I mean? Like...
I think we're all overlooking the big derby that happened this Saturday, Peterborough MK Dons. Are we overlooking that one?
Oh, how'd it go? Did you guys beat the Dons?
Yes, of course we did. 3-0, thank you very much.
Yeah, you wouldn't be bringing it up, I guess. I should have assumed.
He's not normally the one to proffer the Peterborough chat if they lose.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Up to the heady heights of fifth and smashing those scummers, MK Dons. So yeah, gotta love that.
There you go. Well, let's check in on your promotion odds and whatnot, according to the fine people at 538.
No. Do we have to?
Let's bring it up. You are a 45% to make the playoffs. That's not bad. No one's above 47.
Okay.
Right there. 35% for promotion, which is pretty great. That's the fourth best.
Okay.
And 11% to win.
Fourth best to get promoted is not good in a league where three get promoted.
That's why I was sort of slightly tempered in my reaction there. Okay. I'll take it, I suppose.
That's how you bring it down with a bump.
That's a good point, though. I mean, derby-wise, there's obviously the Manchester derby, but... unless Man United stay in their exalted position they're in at the minute, that doesn't feel as big as it maybe could be. I guess Liverpool Man U is, but I guess I'm low on it just because we've not long watched it.
What about the North London? Does that one do anything for you? That's to me like the second biggest one, probably.
Yeah, I mean it doesn't just because of where the teams have sort of crossed over, haven't they? So it just doesn't feel like much to write home about to me.
It's because when Arsenal were a good team and Tottenham, they weren't really up to much, but the fans were super passionate. It therefore became a bigger occasion because Tottenham were the underdogs and had the more vocal fan base, and therefore if they did something, it was even more impressive. Whereas now, like, Arsenal were the shit team with the shit fans. So it's like just there's nothing, that game has nothing going for it really.
Yeah, and Spurs fans are too distracted by the cheese room to say anything during the matches.
No one's allowed in. That really, like, for so many levels, that just doesn't land anymore, and it makes me sad. not the fact that they're saying the cheese room doesn't exist, because I'm very much thinking that's a Denver airport situation, and it is somewhere there. It is there somewhere. But, yeah, just they lie to us.
Do you think it's just like Jose's cheese room, like no one else is allowed in there right now? Just him sitting on a pile of cheddar?
I really hope so. Are we going to go this long into the pod without mentioning that we're sponsored now and we're big time and we're going to retire in the Bahamas? A dream has been achieved and we are finally sponsored. This is Oscar's Everest. This is what he got into podcasting for. And we've been sponsored by Manscaped. Everyone.
Yes, I specifically went into podcasting to be sponsored by a testicle shaving company, which is fantastic.
I mean, you definitely did.
Male care products.
Men's care. Yeah.
Ladies can use it as well.
Correct. Yes.
So yeah, so they got in touch with us and I want to do something. So if you go to manscaped.com, you can get 20% off all products and free shipping if you use our code MOP20. Yay!
Yeah, that's right. They have testicle deodorant, they have boxers, they have t-shirts, they have nose hair trimmer. Ian, I can see your nose hairs from across from the Atlantic. You might want to invest in one of those.
Yeah, maybe I'll put mine in little bunches like you've got your hair, yeah.
He loves the bunches. So yeah, it's been a good week and positive for us. So thank you, Manscaped. We look forward to spamming you all with adverts endlessly.
Yeah, genuinely incredibly exciting. Like, it's that American consumerism. I'm just so excited to record a fucking ad for someone. I mean, and also, you know, money is nice. We love money. Shout out money.
Yeah. Okay, Jesus Christ. But yeah, while we're on the subject of positive news that does bring us money, we got a new Patreon as well.
Yay!
Oh, do you want me to play the old fanfare?
I think we can, because also Patrick Bamford is still underperforming his XG.
Oh, good.
I'm not doing the whole thing.
Every time the name Bamford comes up, we play that.
God. But we got a new Patreon. We welcome Michael Allen, who was the same person who dubbed you the number crunching prick, Koskis.
Slightly salty number crunching prick. Thank
you
very
much.
No, I
added the slightly salty, but yeah. So there you go. We've got a new Patreon, Michael Allen. Welcome to the family. Welcome to the Slack. And yeah, so that's positive news that also gets us money. So it's a win-win.
And if you want to abuse us and call us insults and give us money, by all means, please sign up at patreon.com/milesoffsidepod and join the Slack, etc.
Welcome to the jester from Leicester.
I believe it's Mlester.
No.
Mlester? Mlester?
No. No, you can't pronounce the M.
The M is silent. Gotcha. Okay.
So it's Leicester.
Well, it's my classic American not able to pronounce.
Just do fucking rapid fire news, mate. We need to get out of this quick.
All right, fair enough. So we'll kick things off as we always do 20 minutes into our podcast with our...
Kick things off.
Famous segment.
John Stone to score the brace.
Rapid fire news. Our top story this evening, gentlemen, it is the end of an era. That's right, Mesut Ozil. Arsenal midfielder is set to join Fenerbahce. The German traveled to Turkey on Sunday to have a medical and complete the deal. The 32-year-old still has half a season left on his Arsenal contract, but said goodbye to his teammates at the club's training ground before departing. Ozil has not played for Arsenal since a 1-0 win over West Ham in March.
Wait, that recently?
Yeah, that does feel more recent than I thought.
It's been a long year.
That much is true.
Mesut Ozil, we hardly knew ye.
I don't think we did, really. I feel bad that the English team he went to was Arsenal.
I know, genuinely, like, jokes aside, Ozil at Madrid was brilliant. Absolutely fucking brilliant. Him hooking up with Ronaldo, I believe that season, Mourinho's Madrid team set the record for most goals in a season in Spain, at least up to that point. I'm sure Messi has broken it since then. But he was, like, genuinely, I was very jealous and angry when he signed for Arsenal. Yeah, and then,
there was the Arsenal season where, wasn't it, like, with about 10 games to go, he only had to get 2 more assists to get the assist record or something, and then just did nothing for the rest of the year. Adam, let me know that I'm right or some shit, but I just can't remember what the season is. But then, like, he was just never really, I don't know, he very much with Sanchez, like him and Sanchez together was unbelievable. Like, FPL terms, it was like when, you know, there were times in the last few seasons where you just have Salah and Mane. Or whatever, like you could have Ozil and Sanchez, and they were still just great. But
yeah, absolutely. Well, you don't know when that was that he like was really close?
I'm not here to number things.
Mm, I bet I can guess. Hang on a second, Alexa. When did Fortnite come out?
Fortnite was released on the 21st of July 2017, and it is available on Mac, PC, PlayStation 4. And Xbox One.
All right, well, there you go. Clearly it was Fortnite that derailed Ozil's career.
That's a bit before then.
Yeah, exactly. Speaking of long-standing servants, and we hardly knew ye, except in this case we knew ye all too well, Lucas Piazon, he of the Lone Army, permanent deal, 10 years, 8 loans, 3 first-team appearances for Chelsea. While most players leave the club after a decade, the talk is of testimonials. When Lucas Piazon departed Stamford Bridge on Thursday, Chelsea fans could be forgiven for barely noticing. The 26-year-old Brazilian, yes, that's right, he's only 26, remarkably, was the longest-serving player in the Chelsea squad.
History.
Having theoretically worked under 8 managers.
Can we start an online campaign to get Lucas Piazon a testimonial match for 10 years? He deserves it. It is his right. He should have it. But everyone who plays can only be people who are featured on loan somewhere. Yeah. And it will be all players.
Oh, KDB's coming back for the testimonial.
It has to be worse than that. You have to have 10 or less appearances for your club but have been on loan other places for like 5 or 6 years.
I have one and only one Lucas Piazon memory, given that he only had 3 appearances for Chelsea. That makes sense. I'll briefly run it out. And that was in our 8-0 against Aston Villa, which is, I believe, the club record biggest win in the top flight.
Wow.
And we had 7 different scorers, and he was not one of them. That's it. That's all I remember. Jeez. Now he's 26. He's
I
a child.
I really thought he would have been older than me. I really thought.
Well, you know who is older than you. It's a good place to transition to our next story.
Ian Simpson.
Well, yes, obviously. Quite obviously. But no, Championship side Derby County have appointed England's record goal scorer Wayne Rooney as their new manager on a 2.5-year contract. The 35-year-old, so older than us, but not older than Ian, had an interim charge since Philip Cocu was sacked on November 14, but he has now also officially retired as a player. Rooney has overseen 9 games so far, winning 3 and drawing 4.
Yeah, I'm quite sad about this because it means he's no longer player-manager, and I like to see a player-manager, especially in the 21st century.
Something delightfully old school.
Something that seems so antiquated and weird that I'm sure at one point, like, 3 Premier League teams would have had player-managers at the same time in the 90s. Like,
do you count as a player-manager if you never play yourself?
No, I think to be a player-manager, you just have to have your kit on underneath a jumper or something.
Ready to go.
Okay.
I want to see someone with full kit, but then like the tie, like cashmere sweater, full overcoat. I want to see that. And then they can just sort of rip it away. Like maybe all attached by Velcro or something. So they're just ready to go. They're full pep beforehand, but then they can just rip it off and be John Terry and just go out there. That's what I want to see.
Arsene Wenger would take 20 minutes to get out of his.
Oh, fuck yeah. He wouldn't have a chance. Everyone else has got Velcro. He's done his with buttons and cufflinks.
Do we think he'll do a good job? Derby's been a jumping-off point for some managers, obviously Lampard, but also in the past, historically, you had like Brian Clough was there. Those are the only 2 names that I know.
I mean, they're in the relegation zone, question mark?
Well, the one thing I do know about them is that they've got big financial problems. I think he's got a job on his hands, to be honest,
They are 23rd.
He's definitely got a job on his hands. I think their financial problems sound quite nasty. So I think he'll struggle to build a squad that's going to be... Well, unless he does the sort of loanee thing. Obviously, in the past, they had loanees like Mason Mount and stuff and have done them well.
Mm.
But so if he can do that, then he might be all right. But I think he's going to struggle to get a really good squad of permanent players for the Championship.
Yeah, he's got to be ringing up Ole right now and being like, hey, what United youngsters can you send me? The same way Lampard was on the phone with Chelsea the day he got appointed as Derby manager.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't think people want to go somewhere where they're not going to get paid, though, which sadly is, I don't think they've been paid since November at Derby at the moment. So.
Oh, is it that bad?
Wow. I don't think, this was a few days ago, I saw something that they hadn't been paid for December. So therefore, just, you know.
Right, yeah. Oof.
Chronology. But yeah, good luck, Wayne. Good luck, Wayne.
Have a good one.
Good luck, Wazza. Is that what you guys call him, right? Wazza.
Yeah, of course.
All right, well then let's go over to our final story then. Premier League players have got to follow the rules and set a good example over COVID-19 protocols, says Chief Executive Richard Masters. He wrote to clubs on Wednesday to stress the critical importance of adhering to the strengthened protocols. Clubs were reminded that handshakes, high fives, and hugs must be avoided. And that players should socially distance wherever possible on and off the pitch.
I suppose with players of your own, obviously you can't socially distance with the opposition. But with players of your own team, you're probably not that near them that often. And so maybe there's some merit in saying this with celebrations and stuff. I struggle to believe that they're socially distancing. Obviously, in training, they can't, I presume, unless they're in complete, I don't know, weird bubbles or something. I just, I find it very odd. It feels a bit like sort of lip service to me.
I mean, he did suggest that they start doing practice in those hamster balls, the giant yeah, hamster bubbles yeah, that people okay, run yeah. around in sometimes.
On water as well, please. On yeah. water.
We just invented a new sport, yeah.
Yeah.
But you know what's totally safe is the fucking FA Cup and League Cup. We should definitely keep yep. that going. Just don't handshake yep, it yep, when yep. you're scoring a goal.
Yeah.
Don't shake hands with the people you spend 6 out of 7 days a week with.
I quite enjoyed Madison's celebration of just everyone just get back. And then I think it was Harvey Barnes or someone at the end just went up to him and hugged him anyway.
For me, it's like many things can be true at the same time. Like, for example, I am very annoyed and upset at the perceived exceptionalism and entitlement that a lot of footballers have because they get paid a lot of money. Going out for New Year's, not having retribution, going to watch games, travelling all around the world, etc., 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 when other people don't. And that stirs up feelings of whatever and resentment and being a bit like, kind of fuck you. It feels a bit like a fuck you because you've got money, you can do what you want. However, at the same time, I can also see that it is very much the kind of, once again, it seems to be the ruling classes or whatever that are using footballers as a scapegoat to distract us from what is going on in life. And the simple fact is they did it before, and then Marcus Rashford stepped up and fed a load of kids. So it shut them all, shut Matt Hancock and the rest of them all the fuck up, because they were like, well, look, he's doing his part finally. So what are you doing for the country? And if the main talking point amongst everyone is whether or not footballers should hug or shake hands on the pitch, then they've done their job in distracting you from what is going on in life and their own fucking inability to manage the country. I know we're not a political podcast, but that's just what I'm saying, is if that's what the media are saying, the big problem with COVID is 11 blokes who only see, like, probably don't see that many people, can't shake hands or whatever. Just saying. There's bigger things going on here, guys. There's a pandemic. My triple captain, KDB.
There it is.
Hashtag FPL.
Just side note, I think us not being a political podcast, that ship sailed a while ago.
Yeah. Oh, that's so far gone. All right, well, then let's move on to the fixtures. There are many, many fixtures to go through because there have been 2 game weeks since the last time we recorded. So I just picked out a couple of teams that I thought had some interesting results, and I figure we can go that way. Sound good, gentlemen?
Yes, please.
Lovely.
All right, good. Well, let's start off with Wolves then. Normally not somewhere where you would think to go, but there was a WW Derby yesterday. And Wolves have been on a spectacularly terrible run, so I find that it's mildly worth talking about. So on Tuesday, January 12th, we had Wolverhampton Wanderers 1, Everton 2, Wolves 0.9 to Everton's 0.3 on XG. So a loss, slight Burnleying. And then yesterday, and the big one that people are definitely talking about in the WW Derby, Wolves against one of the W teams. I'm not sure which. They all blend together, but the bad one. Wolves 2, W team 3. Wolves 1.9 to W team's 2.5 on XG.
It's getting too meta. It's getting too meta, Oscar.
Okay, the W team in question is West Brom, which Albion, which is the worst team in the history of time, right?
Come on now, Sheffield United will take exception to that. we're talking about derbies earlier, the Black Country Derby, not just the W Derby in there. But yeah, Wolves have been woeful. Last 10 games, they have conceded the first goal in 9 of them. Guess who the 10th was? And just, yeah, they, like, have very much shown how they rely on Jimenez and Jota. Their squad has been like teenagers. Go back a few weeks ago to when we recorded and we got some team reviews, and a fan got in touch that kind of pointed that out a lot, that they've really been running on the B squad, and a lot of players that would have been okay if they'd have been bedded in gradually, as opposed to no, you're all the ones that are starting to lead the line here, and it's kind of showing that instability a bit, which you wouldn't have thought, because the Wolves have always seemed like they're a very well-run club and done really well. I mean, you forget they're promoted in, what, the last 3 years?
Yeah, relatively recently, for sure. But I think that goes to show something that we've talked about with lots of other teams as well, which is that, like, most teams, even City and Liverpool, and definitely the rest of us, have, like, one or two positions where they cannot afford an injury, because it will just destabilize their entire fucking thing. Right? So, like, a really... really obvious example would be if Heung-min Son went down for Spurs. They'd be fucked. Their entire attack runs through him and Kane. And so, like, without him, they would just have no way to go. And they sold their best striker, and then the other best striker is, like, injured for a very long time, which obviously that you can't plan for or expect. But when you leave yourself that thin, that one injury can derail you completely, like, now we're seeing the effects of that. You know what I mean? Like, it really only takes one or two names sometimes.
And as well, like, you were talking to me before, Oscar, about some new magical stats thing that you've been looking at. And we were looking at the goalkeeper numbers for it that shows that Rui Patricio is, like, one of the worst performing goalkeepers in the league this year.
Yes, so the stat in question, and I can do a Patreon explainer for our Patreons if they have more in-depth questions about it, but it is post-shot XG differential. So in other words, it looks at shots that it knows are on target. It calculates how likely those are to go in, given some extra factors that normal XG wouldn't take into account, like where the shot was hit towards, corner, center, where is the goalkeeper's position relative to that. And it was originally invented to measure like how good people are at finishing. Turns out that's basically impossible to do in statistics, at least as of what we have yet. All we know is that Bamford is bad and Messi is good. But besides that, everyone is pretty much an average finisher that we can tell from the data. But it did turn out to be really useful for measuring how good keepers are, because if someone places a shot really well and has a high expected goals post-shot value, and then the keeper saves it, then they made an amazing save, basically. You can say, like, oh, this number was an amazing save. Like, there it is right there. We saw it with our eyes, and now we have a number for it. But I didn't know that about the Wolves keeper. You said he's, like, towards the bottom?
I don't know. I closed the tab.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
It's not just me!
So, but it's on, like, a scale, and I think at the top with, like, plus six is, like, Nick Pope, which makes sense because, like, Burnley, many bad, and Nick Pope, many good goalkeeper. And right at the bottom with, like, a minus five is Rui Patricio. So I guess, like, if that's, like, a 10-goal differential, like, that's quite a bit.
Yeah. Although I don't think really they'll be in trouble, though. So, like, for all the fuss, like, they've got a 10-point cushion on the relegation zone, right? Maybe more?
Well, yeah, but Wolves have... Their expectations have changed over the last few years. And I accept what you're saying, that it was only a few years ago that they were promoted to the Premier League. But in that very short space of time, they've been really successful. And that's totally altered expectations. They're no longer a team that you'd be thinking they should be dodging relegation. You know, the fact that you're even saying that because they're in, what, 14th or something, I can't remember, is...
Yeah, 14.
It's not good enough for Wolves, as Wolves are now, you know. Their defence has been conceding a lot of XG, so they're putting... If you're saying Patricio's not performing well, the defence is putting him in a position that means he's going to be conceding a lot of goals then, you know, because they're conceding a lot of potential XG. Yeah, it's not looking good for them at the minute. And up front's not much better. I mean, Neto's been decent, but... They've had obviously a lot of people out, and it's not good times for him, definitely not. And old Nuno doesn't look happy at all.
He also, I think, for once has genuinely been making mistakes.
Yeah.
Like, what is he doing with Adama Traore? That's one of the most talented players in the league, and he can't figure out how to use him when they have no one else that good. Build this fucking system around him. That seems a no-brainer to me. He's their best player, especially with Jimenez out and Jota gone. But meanwhile, he's like not even starting every week. So, like, what are you doing? All right, well, let's move on then to another team that had some interesting results over the last couple of games. Probably the big one, honestly, that people would want to talk about the most. But I didn't want to give them the honor of bleeding, so fuck them. And we have Manchester United with two results over the last two game weeks. We had Manchester United 1, Burnley 0, Man United 1.2 to Burnley's 0.7. So a favorable win, but potentially a 1-1 draw in other scenarios with the roll of the dice there. And then, obviously, earlier today, we referenced it already, we took accidental naps and are feeling very well refreshed and rested to record this podcast. At least I did. I slept through most of this. We had Liverpool 0, Manchester United 0, 1.2 to 1.2, so exactly a draw. I tried to stay awake, guys. I genuinely did. I was like, I'm going to have, like, tactical insight. I'm going to take some fucking notes. I had my notes app open on my phone, and I literally fell asleep with my phone in my hand. It was a boring match. But United, best team in the world, right? Top of the league.
A 1-0 against Burnley. Like, I mean, not losing to Liverpool. Like, that's good. That's like a Mourinho level of, I'm just going to stop the other team getting points. So, like, you know, Ole keeps a 3-point cushion from Liverpool, which is a nice place to be. Like, if, you know, we wouldn't have thought a little while ago with how the league was shaping up that potentially at the end of January you could have Man City, 4 points clear of Liverpool again?
Yeah, Man City are going to probably win the league. Like, if I had the ability to gamble legally where I currently live, I would put money on City to win the league, like, right now. Their numbers are on the up, and everyone else's are on the down, and they're just the best team, and Pep seems to have figured out how to mitigate, like, injury and energy consumption in an incredibly tricky year by changing the system to a system that specifically plays slow and stuff. But we'll get to City. I don't want to skip United because I think, like, people genuinely want to hear us talking about United. The fact that they're at the top of the league is something. And when we looked at the tinsel window, they were like number one over the tinsel window unexpected as well.
They,
right,
were, they were literally number one on every stat. I think goals scored, XG, points, everything. So it kind of, maybe it makes sense that then, you know, you have that difficult period. Now, we've said it before, and you can tell if you look at the results just across the smaller game week that we missed out, obviously, last week. You know, there was only one game that had more than two goals. There's 3 1-0s, a 0-0, a 1-1, a 1-2. So, like, really low scoring compared to what we've seen. And then this week, it's kind of been a bit more balanced again. But still, you know, 3 1-0s yesterday, a 0-0 this afternoon. Like, I think it's a lot of teams are starting to see that impact. And where the top teams then, as historically would happen, is you then kind of try to grind out results and try not to exert yourselves to then kind of build up back up again. And so maybe it's kind of a bit of that from United and slowing down, especially like the XG creation isn't particularly high. Like against Burnley, they generated 1.2 and scored one. Against Liverpool today, both teams was 1.2. So I think maybe it's just a bit of that as using this period to kind of try to recharge a bit and get a bit of rotation. Having said that, Fernandes looked furious when he got subbed off. And ooh, I love that drama.
Yeah.
Give me some chaos. Went off like throwing stuff and yeah, like, what the fuck? Wouldn't come off, basically.
Well, also because not even five minutes before then, he'd been telling Wijnaldum, look, you're getting subbed, fuck off. and then Bruno's absolutely furious to see his number go up. Yeah, enjoyable.
I mean, they are trending up, which is that's the concern to me. I don't think that they're one of the four best teams if you look at the entire arc of the whole season so far. I think FB Ref on goal difference per 90 would have them 6th, about level with Spurs, and then it's a pretty sizable jump to Chelsea and Villa, about level with each other. And then Liverpool, and then a huge fucking jump up from that to City. City are running away with the underlying numbers at this point. But so United still aren't like top four over the course of the whole season. But the way that they're trending, the way they seem to be gelling, it's so hard to not give into like confirmation bias / hashtag narrative because they have looked good and the results have been there. But I think that the way the numbers are, you also lend yourself to very easily like one early goal completely fucking a result. It's not like they're dominating or playing teams off the pitch the way Liverpool or City do, or Chelsea when they're running, which they haven't been, but, you know,
for
a couple of weeks now. Yeah. But like, you know, to me, actually, that's actually a perfect example, right? Like Chelsea are in crisis. Like one or two fluky goals, one or two fluky results in the other direction. When your XG numbers are that close on a per 90 basis, like they're less than a half goal difference per 90. It's 0.36. So like that's not super far off of even.
It's just still mad how truncated it is for everyone. And like, I know I rip you about the Chelsea and everyone saying in crisis, but it's like literally for the amount of shit results that Chelsea have had, which has been quite a lot recently. Sorry, I know this. Eventually I'll get to the supporting you bit and not just the digs of your team's shit. but it's like if Chelsea had just had three more wins, which isn't a lot, then they'd be top of the league. Like, I still go back to Palace having those shit losses against Burnley and Newcastle. Like, if Palace won those, they'd be at seventh now, where Chelsea are. And it's like, it's how tight things are. And we saw kind of from the full 20-team reviews, is that I think every single fan of their clubs, apart from like Sheffield United and West Brom, and maybe Fulham, all think the same way about their clubs this year, that they're like super down and like just like it can be so close. And I think there's a big feeling of that everywhere, apart from, and especially Man United fans had that. until they put together five good results across the Tinsel window. I think it was four wins and a draw off the top of my head. And that was enough to propel them so many more places that all of a sudden, old Man United fans are back. They're all lauding it over Twitter. It is how things were. And I think everything's just in such a constant state of flux that when you step back from it for a minute, this is what we have all been asking for a good few years. Like, halfway into the season, it's still super competitive. Like, 5 points separate first and sixth at the minute after 17.
Or 5 points separate ninth to third.
Yeah.
Like, it's nothing. It's really not a lot. Like, and that is part of, like, what's really frustrating to me as a data-leaning fan is that from one week to another, it's like, oh, Chelsea in fourth, Chelsea in ninth, crisis. And it's like, no, like, we're like one or two results. Like, it's super fucking much. We're not even halfway through the season. I know that it's the middle of January, but like, so timeline-wise, we're like, oh, wow, this is really the time when things start to blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Like, we're not even halfway through the season because it's been a weird year. We started late, you know, all the COVID stuff. Everybody knows what's going on, obviously, but like, it is so bunched up. And so as a data-leaning fan, that's why I cling to the underlying numbers right now, especially, is because, like I said last time, like, that's more indicative, likely, you know, if you're betting on probability. Like, there's a reason that gambling companies don't lose money. It's stats. Like, spoiler alert. You know, that's why I'm, like, up on Chelsea compared to most Chelsea fans, definitely. Mm. And, like, non-Chelsea fans as well. I do feel like a crazy person being like, Chelsea aren't that bad. Chelsea aren't that bad. But, yeah. Like... it's so fucking frustrating. It's so tiring in general. And I guess we can move to Chelsea just because there's like, we can talk to them about them for 5 seconds. They beat Fulham 1.4 to 0.5. They beat them. They beat them on XG. Fulham down to 10 men. It was frustrating that they didn't do better against the 10-man Fulham. I was sitting there watching being like, why aren't we creating more? Why aren't we like tearing them apart? And I think that's the influence of like I gotta fucking quit Twitter, man. I'm just so negative about Chelsea emotionally when the rational side of me is like, dude, relax. Like, it's nothing to be stressed about yet. Like, maybe. Everything's so fucking bunched up that, like, ninth to third is nothing, but, like, quote-unquote regular people. I sound like such an asshole. Fuck it. I don't care. Lean into it at this point. Everyone knows what I am. Like...
You speak your truth, Bunches.
Regular people are like, oh, Chelsea are in your ninth. They're shit. And it's like, nah.
No.
They're not. But I... ugh. Sorry,
the problem is you mentioned bookies, and at the minute they have Lampard third favourite to be sacked next.
Yes, because narrative can get a manager sacked, much more so than performance. Narrative matters in the real world, but at the end of the year, it's the stats that get you where you are in the table. You know what I mean? Like, it's a long way from now to the end of the season.
So the real world only exists between now and the end of the season, and then at the end of the season, fake world takes over.
They converge into one world is really how I would like to phrase it, but sure. Yeah. All right. Well, let's move to the team that is likely to win the league then, I think, and that's City. City beat Brighton on Wednesday. Woo, the mighty Brighton. 2.9 to 0.2 on XG. Ooh, oh my gosh. And then obviously City demolishing Palace 4-0 today. I don't have the XG up for that yet. I'm sure XG Philosophy on Twitter probably has it.
Info Goal have got the Man City Palace matches. Man City only 1.14, but to Crystal Palace is 0.05.
Oh,
oh my gosh. Did they take any? I guess they took one shot at least, but.
There is two shots on their shot map for Crystal Palace. One on the sort of upper left of the penalty area, and the other nearer the centre circle.
That is a ridiculous, and I saw it. That was when Eze tried to lob Edison, and he wasn't far off. He wasn't, but obviously, like, XG wise, it's ridiculous. Yeah, but we're not talking about Palace. You wanted to talk about City.
Yeah, City. So City are great, right? Like, City are great, and it is a tactical shift. It's on purpose. It doesn't feel. It passes the eye test. It passes the numbers test. That are almost in reality at the top of the table, especially with that game in hand. So, like, the narrative slash, you know, observed outcomes is also there. Like, they're just good. That's it.
So, do you subscribe to this thing I've read about that Pep was, like, deliberately reining them in this early part of the season to save them for what he knew would be a... awful season fitness-wise because everything's so packed in and so forth. Do you subscribe to that, or is that just a sort of happy way to explain what's happening now?
It's a very easy thing to say after the fact.
Isn't it? Yeah.
To me, what was happening, that my read on it, is that they were in a transition period between two tactical systems and two sets of players being the like most important players. Like, some of those people carried over, Kyle Walker, for example, but he had to learn a new way to play right back. And to us, it doesn't look that different. But to the people that break these things down and who, like, when you read their articles, you're like, oh, fuck, that is a really good analysis. That's not something that I caught with my own eye when I was watching. Like, it is a pretty radically different formation, a much, much radically different, like, structure in terms of, like, what the expectations and the roles are for individual players, even if they're, like, hanging out in the same basic area of the pitch. And so that's going to lead to a natural, like, period of instability where they're like, oh, they don't really look like they know what they're doing. They look kind of off. They look like they're tentative or hesitant when they're playing, all that sort of stuff, right? And so that's, I think, what we were seeing there as they fully internalized their new sets of instructions. They're a different team. Like, they're the same players, the same coach, and they look similar. There's still a lot of cutbacks and stuff, but yeah, I mean, that's my read on it. It was just a transition between two tactical systems, and now that they got it, they're just going to fucking run away with this. Like,
Okay.
What about you, Chuck, though? Do you think that he was, like, on purpose conserving stuff? Like, was there more mind games at play there? Or was it, what? Like, what's your read on that?
I think, it makes sense. Like, you have to have logics for everything, right? And it's how you're going to play it. And I certainly think it would have played on the mind of a lot of managers, and it's whether you take the tactical advantage of trying to get to an unassailable lead. So you just try to go for it early and then hold on, and then, you know, you're naturally going to rain. It's going to happen naturally that you get tired and whatever. But it does feel very easy to say after the fact, yeah, this is what I was doing because our form dipped a little bit. But, like, we were just getting by. Because if they were just getting by and they were losing, like, every game, then he would have had to change it. You know what I mean? But there's something to be said for it, and it would make sense that you could look at it and take the different approaches of, you see that massive fixture congestion, but you wouldn't necessarily think about that for a team of Man City's kind of quality. I mean, you think like a lower league team, maybe a lower league team, but certainly a lower down the team league team, that they would target specific fixtures to try to get the most out of those. Rafa Benitez was probably the perfect manager for that. And it was probably why you could look at him at Newcastle and you couldn't necessarily judge his results, because there were certain games where he just did not try to get anything out of. But then when he did, it was like, we get that win, bang, right, next one. We rest and you make sure you conserve. It's kind of the opposite model to Marcelo Bielsa, where like there is something to be said for, you know, yes, you're playing Man United, yes, you've got nothing to lose, you're four goals down, it's the 70th minute, and you keep going attack, 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 attack. Like, good on you. And as a viewer of that, it is fun to watch because you're actually giving it a go, something that people have been saying that they want from championship teams or their own teams for years and years and years. But on the flip side of that, it's now I've seen why the teams burn out and why it's mad that Karen Carney gets the slack about that. And because, you know, obviously for whatever reasons, Leeds decided to dig her out personally on their Twitter account.
Whatever reasons. I wonder what those reasons might be.
Scum. And since that, they haven't scored a goal. The super attacking Leeds. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So,
Looked absolutely gone out against Brighton as well.
Against Brighton in the first half, like, this super attacking team, they generated 0.2 XG, and Brighton were only playing five defenders in that match. Like, they have been playing seven. Against Man City, they played six centre-backs. That's how much, that's how fucked their team is. It's like there was a centre-back playing as a winger, one playing as a defender, one playing as a central midfielder, sorry. It's like, they are fucked. And you're this super attacking team, and you can only get 0.2 against them? Like, if this is the turning point in Leeds' season and why then those knock-on effects happen, is that you've wasted all that energy on games that you wouldn't necessarily have won. And they were for the first part of the season anyway. Sorry, we've got so much sidetracked here from Man City, but just any chance to dig on Leeds. But in the first half of the season, Leeds were doing that in every game, and they were getting results out of the games they were supposed to get results from. And the teams that were better than them were smashing them. granted, like the first game, it was like the Liverpool 4-3 and it was a massive war of attrition and it was mad. But like now, if you're not going to see that from teams, is it worth it? Is there going to be a tactical switch that then justifies it, which is what I would say Pep would have done probably if his tactical switch, and we said it, the way they were playing was slightly different, hadn't been working during the festive congestion period because they just weren't going to get the break now. And everyone's got to make up games. And everyone, you know, the top teams, if they progress further in the competitions, are going to have a game every 3 days between now and the end of time.
Yeah, no, literally, if you look at Spurs' fixtures, it's every 2.8 days from now to June.
Ooh, wow.
On average.
That's insane. But teams like that, teams like Pep's City, want to win every single game. So that's why it was just quite a weird, different tack that I think we're not used to seeing from Pep.
And honestly, this is going to be a piping hot take, but to me, this is the most impressive thing that Pep has done in his career. Everyone's like rolling their eyes at me. Go ahead. Get your roll. I roll out. Give you 3 seconds. Okay, good. Now that you can listen again. Honestly, like, what he did at Barca was unbelievably impressive. They were the best team of all time, club team of all time, probably, looking at their trophies, looking at their players, whatever. But, like, he also inherited Messi, Iniesta, Xavi, Puyol, Piqué, all those, Pedro, Fabregas, all those dudes from the youth squad. So, like, that's, you know, you're going to do well with those guys. Then he goes to Bayern Munich. They were the best team in the world. He made them better, but they were already the best team in the world. Right, this, he's building a fucking bicycle on the fly and turning it into the best team in England after getting thoroughly, like, dismantled, I guess, by Liverpool, at least in the actualized results last year, because we talk about underlying, blah, 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 blah. But, like, he's changing this as they go. Like
the bicycle got dismantled?
No, he's building the bicycle on the fly, meaning, like, while he's riding it. That's an expression. Is that not an expression? Did I make that up? Sounds like an expression.
Did he dismantle the bicycle first?
Yes. Yeah, yeah. So he's riding his bicycle along the Thames, or what's the river in Manchester?
Fuck, who knows?
Do they not have a river? Every city has a river. Whatever. Let's say he's on like vacation in the Thames. He's riding his bike on the Thames. He notices that the back tire is flat. So he like pumps a front wheelie and then fixes the tire while he's doing a front wheelie and then puts it back down. And then not only is he back riding his bicycle, it's even faster and better. And now now the bicycle is better than Liverpool. And we're all going to just watch it win the league.
Right, okay.
I genuinely assumed I'd misheard, but I didn't. So, nope. Yeah, no. Fine, that's not a saying, but you explained it brilliantly.
Pep and his bicycle.
Pep and his bicycle. Oh, well, I was going to say we should talk about Fulham, but I don't think we're going to top Pep and his bicycle, so do you want to just go to listener stuff?
Well, you can say poor Fulham. Feel bad for him. Who's the guy that got sent off? Anthony Robinson. Hang your head in shame. I know you're listening.
Yeah. Don't feel sorry for him.
In a relegation scrap. Finally turning the corner. Everyone's getting fucking COVID. Scott Parker's pulling out magical draws left, right and centre. I know what I'm going to do. Red card. You dick.
And I saw some Fulham fans on Twitter mad about it. Because, you know, Aspi did sort of sell it a bit. Right. But this guy fucking flew in. He was airborne with 2 feet. How are you going to complain about a red card?
Well, Aspi may have sold it a bit, but the fact is that if Aspi hadn't have been in the air, that could have been a leg breaker.
Oh, absolutely.
Like, so he sort of had to sell it a bit to preserve his health.
He was upside down at one point with his leg. You know, you guys know what upside down means. Because the fucking force of the tackle hit his leg so hard that he did a rotation.
Sorry, it's not the same as saying that he'd fix a bicycle on the road.
It's cool while he's on it.
Yeah.
He's on his penny farthing. Who fucking knows?
Anyway, let's go to listener stuff. We've only got a brief one, but it's FPL, so let's cover that. Patreon Tom Townley says, if you had to invent an FPL chip, what would it be and what would it replace?
Ooh.
And then Sam Danby comes in on that as well and says that the Norwegian version of the game had an all-out attack, but every attacker got double points.
Oh, how does that work? Like, you're front three.
Let's go through these, actually. I want to, one at a time.
Oscar doesn't want to come up with his own ideas.
I have my own idea, but let's save ours for the end.
Well, the all-out attacks, well, I'm assuming your midfield and three attackers all get double points. I don't know, but...
I like that.
The all-out attack chip wasn't very good when we had it, because it was just swapping out a defender. I mean, often your defender would outscore him anyways. He also said the Norwegian game had Rich Uncle, which sounds really... Rich Uncle was free hit, but with unlimited funds.
Oh, I like that. You know what? If that was around, I might get back into FPL because the budget thing is the thing that pisses me off the most. Well, and one transfer per week. That's what pisses me off the most.
What? You've literally never in all your years of FPL only made one transfer a week.
So right, that's why I hate it.
Why are you complaining? You were never limited by it. You just rolled with it and just spunked points.
Well, I want to do it without the points hits, without the cost.
Without the points. I'd like to play FPL, but no one earns points. Communism.
No, everyone gets expected points based on what was supposed to happen.
Yeah, there you go. Expected fantasy.
Oh my God, he's going to create a game.
This is layers upon layers.
Instead of assists and goals, it's expected assists and expected goals.
A defence chip, you can't remember the name of it, and where all five defenders played get double points. God, that's you're looking for a dull week there, aren't you? Watching for games open for nothing but clean sheets.
Yeah.
Pass on that.
And one where the captain and vice that week, captain and vice captain got double points.
Yeah. Oh, damn it. I wish I had read this because that's my suggestion. I call it double captains.
Double captains.
We got a triple captain and we got double captains.
Yeah, I'd like it to be spread out a bit. Like a vice captain to mean something.
Like 1.5 points.
Yeah, like every week.
Yeah.
I think that's the problem because I think like as a one shot, like free hits good, bench boost is all right. Everyone like gets in a tizzy about it.
Oh, they very much do.
Triple captains, yeah, it's fun, isn't it? Triple captain, God forbid anyone changes their mind on their triple captain though. It's all right. I'm not paid for FPL advice, so it's fine.
So
like I think they're quite balanced because like you said, all out attack was shit. Like it was just,
yeah.
It was only good if you had injured defenders. Basically,
yeah, like, yeah.
If you couldn't get anything out and playing a 2-5-3,
was your only way out. Yeah,
yeah, but yeah, I'd like a vice captain every week or yeah, double captains. I'm going with Oscar's double captains.
What about you, Ian? What's your dream chip?
Play the Peterborough team 1 week when I know they're playing MK Dons and Sammy Smodics can score 2 goals. Come on,
let's. Oh, what? Just get someone in for their points. Any league. Messi, yeah. Every week.
Every single week. Play that chip every week. I would like the the FPL Cup, to be actually something that's worth playing because no one gives a shit about it, do they? And it could be quite good. If you had like a separate squad where every week you picked a new, like just for the cup, you picked a free hit team every week.
Ooh.
Then that would make the cup sort of fun and actually mean something because, you know, then anyone who's not playing anymore, because obviously they wouldn't pick their team, they would just be out. So you could deal with that in the qualifying round. You could say, this is the qualifying round of the cup, pick your free hit FPL cup team. Then you get a qualifying lot and then you play it from there with free hit teams every week. Like I say, entirely separate to your actual squad.
Yeah, I'd
like
that.
Just make it actual fun, you know, because it's quite fun putting a free hit team together. But,
when it has no consequence, when you don't have to deal with the same shit team again the next
yeah.
week.
Yeah, exactly.
So Ian's chip is make FPL fun.
Yeah, why not? Yeah.
Find a way to make it fun. I like it.
Yeah. That'd be well good. Like, you always have a 100 billion budget, but player prices don't change in that competition.
Or they do, or they reset every week. That's fine.
You could add it, because at the minute, the cup starts in like the 17th week. And you have to be in the top, what, like 50% or whatever to get through. Well, why not from game week one, that like the cup can only be entered, like you get entered into group stages. And so like, unless you're in at game week one, you can't be in the cup. Because you know people create like 300,000 teams or whatever. So you start game week one, you will then play a round robin in that league with like 4-5 teams in total. That takes you to 16 game weeks. That's then when the knockout round starts. And just like something, because at the minute, everyone goes, oh, I didn't qualify, or literally everyone is out at the first round anyway.
I would come back to FPL for that. I love a weekly pick'em. There are other games that are weekly pick'ems. Yahoo used to have one, and Taga had one. The Taga one I was fucking crazy good at. I was like top 100 in the world, like several years in a row.
There's only 200 people playing it, but...
it was a few thousand, but...
Only beat who you're playing.
Because I'm good at a weekly pick'em, because that's like... There's no constraints. There's no budget. It's just like, what 10 players are going to do well this week? Like, I'm That's better for me. I don't know.
Yeah.
Fuck long-term planning and stuff. Like, I have no patience.
Uh-huh.
We know. So I would very much be in on a weekly pick'em.
I'd also like to add something that they've had on the Euro and the World Cup fantasy football games is that in the middle of the game weeks, you can put your subs in and you can change your captain as long as that player hasn't played yet. And I quite like that as actually then you're managing the team as opposed to what happens at the minute, which you might go, I'm going to make one change, then I'm going to leave it, then I'm going to stare at it for 4 days and just be like, oh, this is nothing. So for example, if you had five players on the first day of the game week, all of their scores come in. Then if you've got a player on the bench
who could be really good,
you can sub them on.
Yeah.
Or if your captain was one of those five players and he only got 1 point, you can move the captain chip to a player who hasn't played yet.
As a gamble.
But you can never go back, right? So you could go like higher and higher and higher. And that just makes it a bit more engaging. And I really like that with the World Cup and the Euros ones that they've done.
That's a huge part of why I like Fantrax so much more too, is that like you're really involved with managing like during the game week. Like I'm going out, I'm checking lineups, and then I can still sub people in and out with like an hour to go. You know what I mean? Like, and Sunday too. If I have a player playing Sunday that I'm like, oh, you know what? This guy's starting on Saturday that I didn't realize was going to start. I'll put him in and then I'll take the risk on the Sunday guy just blanking or not doing well. You know what I mean? Like
the only thing with that is that FPL, I think, does hit a nice sweet spot between casuals and people like us who would play that sort of game where you have to be super involved. Because I remember when they briefly flirted with Ultimate FPL, where you had to pay a fiver or something.
Yeah, and you had a bigger squad or something.
You had a huge squad, yeah. And you could make changes during the game week, similar to what you said there, Chuck. But like, I remember within 3 game weeks, I was like, I've missed stuff. I can't be bothered to carry on with this, you know. And I'm fairly engaged, but it was just a bit much. So,
but I think that's a bit too much. Like, you don't need that many. Like, you could still have the 15. It's not like during the game week you can make transfers to change your team during that. Like, any transfers you make would only come into effect the next game week. But, like, they do it in the World Cup and Euros because there's no gaps in between. The games are just every single day. So it effectively becomes game days within game weeks because you have the group stages. It's like 20 days of games every single day. I don't know. I just think it would be a bit more fun. I think... Yeah, if it lends itself to being a bit more active and engaged, because like Oscar said, it's just a bit stale. Like, they haven't really changed anything for ages and open up more opportunities for scoring and more points. Open up the bonus, the bonus point system, make it go from 5 to 1, for example, rather than, you know what I mean? So like more players or like second assists come into it or,
okay,
I don't know, something.
Mm. Or even just making mini leagues structurally different, which I think a lot of other platforms allow. Like, maybe in our mini league, the scoring system could be different, for example.
Yeah.
In the Miles Offside Patreon League, the scoring system is just the bonus point system. Basically, our suggestions are make the game less shit.
Make better. Make do good and fun.
But let's play our own game now. It's time.
Oh, shit.
So I'll pad while you get your stuff out.
No, no.
Why don't you explain the game to the people?
I'll just pad with music. So the Bluffer is sponsored by Manscaped, maybe. It's a game where you come up with a question that has multiple answers to it, and then that question is bid on by the two competitors about how many answers they think they can get. And ultimately, someone has to call the other one's bluff and say, you have to answer that many. So hopefully that's been enough time for Chuck to get his questions out.
Oh, yeah. No, I thought you were just going to keep padding so that I could write the whole thing.
Oh, you got to actually do it.
Nah, it's all right. It's all right. I have got 3. Thank you for your lovely description. The Bluffer is brought to you by manscaped.com.
It's officially not.
It is not. We need to be very clear. It is not.
What's the bluffer like with balls? The fluffer. Buff Your Balls.
Wasn't Ball My Bluff something?
Manscape and Ball Your Bluffs.
Ball Buff My Bluffs, yeah.
This is never staying in. Right, I've got three. So, Ian, the scores are 4 to me, 4 to Oscar, 3 to Ian. But Ian's just presented for 2 weeks, so it could just all go 4-4-4 again. And that would just be weird. So, I've got three categories, Ian. I'll let you pick between what category, I guess, is that's food and drink, maybe. Football or geography?
Food and drink.
According to some website, can't remember which one, never mind, blow past it. I have pulled the top 20 fast food chains by the number of outlets in the world. So effectively the number of food and drink providers across the globe. Top 20, how many do you think you can name, Ian?
I'll start low, I'll go 4.
4? Oscar?
I got 7.
Whoa.
Yes.
Okay. I will go... I'll go 8.
Yes. Oscar's going to go for his normal tactic of adding 3.
Not this time, no. It backfired last time.
I think it's backfired every time.
I mean, I have 4 points, so can't have backfired every single time. I'll go 9.
9, okay. Advance on 9, Ian Simpson.
No, I don't want to go to halfway, so...
I mean, I would say... Is that definite 100% out?
Yeah. I've said it now, yeah.
All right, fair enough. Because I would have said, like...
You think I can get there?
Yeah, no, I think you could get a lot higher than that. But never mind. Oscar, you've got to name 9 of the top 20 fast food chains by number of outlets.
McDonald's, obviously.
Yes, McDonald's is 2nd with 38,695.
Is Subway number 1?
Subway is number 1, 42,600.
Very good.
So that's the top 2.
I'm going to bank on most of these being American chains that are also everywhere else.
Okay.
That might backfire, but Burger King / Hungry Jack's if you're in Australia.
Burger King is 5th, 18,838.
Burger King is 5th? Oh boy. Oh, no, that's too big of a risk. I'm going to say Chipotle. No, I just fucked it.
Fucking shit. Wow, you are going to...
Can I rattle more off? I know I lost, but I have more.
Yeah, because you're going to kick yourself here. Because I would bet that there is a point where they are pretty much all American, and some are just domestic American, really. But right. You could easily rail all of these off.
Yeah.
But
Wendy's.
Wendy's, yeah.
Wendy's is 12th, 6,490.
12? Five Guys?
Five Guys, nope.
Oh, I would have said Five Guys, so I would have been out
there
anyway.
There you go.
Five Guys is a really recent brand. Like, that would be mad if they were... So, the lowest on this list is 4,000.
KFC.
KFC's 4th, 24,000.
Taco Bell?
Taco Bell is 9th, 7,363.
Pizza Hut?
Pizza Hut is 6th, 18,703.
Is Nando's on there? That's the one that I was on the fence about saying.
Yeah, I don't know whether that would be classed as fast food.
Yeah.
No, okay. Nando's isn't on there. And yeah, like Ian said, I don't know whether it'd be classified. But I will rattle through them now. In 20th is Costa Coffee. Doesn't have a specific number, but 4,000 plus. They're everywhere. Also, shout out to Greggs for having 2,050 Greggs outlets only in the UK.
Yeah.
no, Brexit means Brexit, guys. In 19th is Jollibee, which is, I think that's South Central America somewhere, Oscar? Jollibee? No, Jollibee is somewhere in Asia. Can't remember where. It's a fast food chain in Asia.
Okay.
Fourth out, about 4,600. Above that, we have Tim Hortons, we then have Little Caesars and Dairy Queen.
Blimey, I would have struggled, I think.
It's the trophy they all want to win, the Papa John's.
Yay!
Orange Julius, you could have had Hardee's was next. Then Wendy's, you said. Baskin Robbins counts. Hunt Brothers Pizza, never heard of it.
Never had it.
No. 9, Taco Bell. Then above that, Dunkin' Donuts, Domino's Pizza, Pizza Hut, Burger King, KFC, Starbucks was 3rd that you missed. And then McDonald's and Subway top it off. So that is A.2 Stim Dog Millionaire. Give yourself a ding, mate. Thank you very much. Oscar, you get to decide the category now. You have got football or geography.
I'll go geography.
You will go geography. Okie dokie. Let me just zoom out so I can get all these in, because there are 54 answers.
Oh my God.
54? Is that what you just said?
Why is there 54 answers? Because there are 54 countries in the continent of Africa. And I'm looking how many you can name. And by country, I mean a sovereign state that's a member of the United Nations in its own right. So how many of the 54 countries of Africa can you name?
I'll start off with 10.
Okay, 12.
Very rare that Ian doesn't just go up by one integer.
It is rare, you're
right. I'll go 13.
14.
Wow, we've slowed down that much already, guys.
Yeah, I think I can go more. I'm just sort of...
I'd hope so.
Yeah.
15?
16.
Oscar?
Oof.
Put the atlas down.
That's tough.
54!
Yeah, but it's hard. It's 54, hard.
54. We've charted in like 38 of these countries.
You know it's harder than that, Chuck. Come on.
Just come on. Like, go through the alphabet. Like, get one of each letter on the alphabet. Move along. Go up. Come on.
Yeah. All right. I'll go. You know what? I'll go 19.
Yes. 19.
Come on, Stimson.
The Scarlet Stimpernel. Stim Kardashian.
Go 20.
Stim Jong-un.
Yeah, I'll go 20.
I'll go 21.
Yeah.
No, I'm out.
Fuck.
Okay. So, Oscar, you have got to name 21 of the 54 countries on the continent of Africa. I'm going to say the Richard Osman line again. And by country, I mean a sovereign state that's a member of the United Nations in its own right.
Right. Let's rattle through these. Come on.
Yeah. Please go slow.
Oh, fuck.
Yes. South Africa.
Ding. South Africa.
Ethiopia.
Ding.
Morocco.
Ding. 3.
Ghana. Did I say Ghana? That's going to be hard for me, is remembering what I said and I didn't say, because there's no order to this.
Ding.
Nigeria.
Ding. Yes, Nigeria.
Democratic Republic of Congo.
Naturally. Big shout out to
the DRC.
The DRC! It's the motherfucking DRC.
Namibia.
Namibia.
Ladies. Yes.
Let's go the one that everyone forgets, and that's Madagascar off the coast.
Does everyone forget it? Ding. Correct.
As being part of Africa? At least over here, I think.
Yeah, but you could say that a lot about your geography skills, so.
Fair enough. Fair enough. Let's do up by Morocco. Algeria, all the French ones.
Algeria, yes. At this point, I really should have been counting how many you've got.
11.
Thanks, Ian. You're halfway there. No, wait. What did he say? 21.
He's over
You've got
half,
10
yeah.
more to go. 10 more to go.
Ivory Coast.
Oh, well. See, it's Cote d'Ivoire, but I'll give it to you.
Come on.
Oh, thanks. Thanks. Very, very generous. Of you. Oh, everyone's favorite douchebag, Chad.
Oh, dear.
I think I got Chuck with that one.
He's gone.
Right, I really wondered where you were going with
that.
Yeah,
I did.
I was like, Idi Amin?
Did I say Cameroon yet?
You did not, but there it is.
All right. I am all over here. Burkina Faso.
Oh, one of my favorites.
It's a good one, right? That's a good name.
Yeah, 6 to go. Capital is Ouagadougou.
The two that always sound the same, Mali and Malawi.
Yeah, I mean, they didn't sound the same there, but yes. Correct, so that's another 2. So what's he got to get now, Ian? 3?
He's got to get 4, that's 17.
Regular Congo, not the Democratic Republic one.
Yes, the ones that hate democracy and republics. Congo.
Famously.
Famously.
The one that was started by slaves, by the US slaves, the ones that went back. Liberia, that's the name.
Right, okay, ding. Yeah.
2 more.
Did I say Sudan?
You did not, but Sudan is an answer, yes.
One more.
Oh, God. There's so many that I know.
Correct.
Rwanda.
Verlander! There he goes, 21. I mean, there was just the other 33 to choose from.
Yeah, I could rattle off some more too, but...
Yeah, evidently. You took your fucking time over it that time, though. Yes, well done. Angola, Benin, Botswana, Burundi, Cape Verde, Central African Republic, Comoros, Djibouti, Equatorial Guinea, Eritrea, Eswatini, Gabon, Gambia, Guinea, Guinea-Bissau, Lesotho, Libya, Mauritania, Mauritius, Mozambique, Niger, Sao Tome and Principe, Senegal, Seychelles, Sierra Leone, Somalia, South Sudan, Tanzania, Togo, Tunisia, Uganda, Zambia, Zimbabwe.
Wow.
So there we go. So point to Oscar. Ding. Give him a ding.
Nope.
Thank you very much. And so the final category then to Ian. We have got football for you. And so I have pulled, of the last 10 years, the top 25 goal scorers in all competitions worldwide for the years 2011 to 2020 inclusive.
Wow. I like that, though. That's yeah, that's a tricky one. How many did you say we're gunning for?
So I went the top 25 because, like I said before, this is all players, all competitions, in so international cup competitions. It only doesn't count friendlies and those sort of things.
Of the last 10 years?
Of the yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Top I like the question. That's
I like the question, but that's fucking tough, man.
That's a, yeah, it is hard. That's a thinker.
Yeah, I'm not going to lie. There's some players in here you would never have heard of, but there is a substantial chunk that you would have. So it's like with the fast food outlets. It's how high you go before you...
25. I'll go 5.
Oscar?
I'll go 7.
7. Ian, you're going to go higher than 7?
Yeah, I'll go 8.
I'm trying to not write things down, but go through them in my head, Ian.
I don't care. I don't care.
9?
If we didn't let Ian write them down, like, all of our bluffer games would just be so boring.
Yeah.
Sorry, so you said 9. Yeah, I'll go 10.
10. Right, we're nearly at that magical 50% mark.
Go for it. Go for it. I think this lends itself to saying something early wrong. So I'm not
you
have
I think
the
you might be right, yeah.
Okay. Well, we have had similar categories in the past, so there could be a sort of Venn diagram there, but... And it's not like Oscar to allow someone to take it away from him, so...
It's not, no.
Ian, I will remind you, I need 10 of the top 25 goal scorers from all competitions worldwide from 2011 to 2020 inclusive.
Okay. Aguero?
Ding, yes. Aguero is 8th, 302 goals.
Suarez?
Luis Suarez, 5th, 335 goals.
Ronaldo?
Which one?
Cristiano.
Thank you. He is first, 550 goals. So that's 3.
I wonder who's second.
Messi.
Lionel Messi, incredibly, 549 and second. Yeah, so one goal between them in 10 years. Madness.
Neymar.
Neymar, 7th, 327.
Ibrahimovic.
Zlatan, he is 4th, 340.
Rooney.
No way.
Boo!
That was stupid.
That was crazy, man. Fucking madness.
That was stupid. Yeah, I don't know. Well, I was thinking of countries and I just lost my mind. I've got a winning music for you, Oscar.
That's me. Very good. Thank you, sir.
Congratulations. The man, Oscar the Puente. I mean, what else did you have on your list there, Ian? Did you have Lineker?
No. No, I know. The pressure got to me, as it often does.
Lewandowski?
Oscar, do you want to rattle off the rest of the top 10 for me?
Is Lewandowski on there?
Lewandowski's 3rd, 417. So it goes 550, 549, then 417 to Lewandowski, then 340 to Ibrahimovic. So any more you want to rattle off?
Yeah, what about Thomas Müller?
No, Thomas Müller is not.
Oh, I had him written down as well, so I would have fallen down on a few counts. Okay, fine.
There you go.
Cavani?
Cavani's 6th, yep. 3-3. As well, one goal separates Cavani and Suarez.
Right, okay.
Wow. Blimey.
A madness.
That's mad.
That is pretty cool.
Any more that you want to throw out there?
Kane?
Harry Kane, all of his goals, basically. 236. Oh, so,
yeah. When I'm thinking of English strikers, I just go Rooney. Why wouldn't I?
Yeah. Fucking hell. Because you're living in the fucking past.
I know.
It is. So,
based on the decade.
But just to say, for clarity, between 9th and 1st, there's about a 300-goal difference. Wow. And then from 9th to 25th is 278 to 227. So, some of these are so close. So, if we go from 25th, he always pops up in these lists, but he's so disrespected. Edin Dzeko, 227 goals.
I thought you were going to say Nicholas Bentner.
Lord Bentner. Then above, yeah, I don't know a lot of these players, so apologies. Carlos Salcedo, is 228. Then Mo Salah and Antoine Griezmann. 229, then Burak Yilmaz on 234, Kane in 20th on 236, then Abderrazak Handala, 237, Nemanja Nikolic is 242, Ali Ashfaq is 242, Gonzalo Higuain is also 242. We then have Ali Mabkout on 250, Omar Al-Somar on 255, Big Rom Lukaku, 258.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I guess he's been having a hell of a time in Italy. That makes sense.
Yeah, so that probably bulks it up. No, he probably still would have been in this list anyway. Also, speaking of disrespected strikers, Karim Benzema, 259. Then Eran Zahavi, Sebastian Tagliabue on 265. And Aubameyang is in ninth.
Oh, my God.
278. Then it's Aguero, Neymar, Cavani, Suarez, Ibrahimovic, Lewandowski, Messi, and Ronaldo.
I think I thought a decade was longer than it is.
I think you did. Also, you thought it was just a
At your age, a decade is just a drop in the bucket.
Bleak. Fucking bleak. So, come on, another point to Oscar. That brings us to 5-4-3 overall. And it's Oscar's hosting next week. So we're obviously in the middle of a game week as we record. The big DGW.
Oh, how's that going? We should check on our teams, I guess.
Should we check on our teams? I captained the wrong defender. Because John Stones is on 21 points. Oh, and I captained Cancelo for one point. But yeah, pre-bonus, mate. I'm on 51. Yeah.
Wow, that's good.
The robots are on 49 right now. The robots triple captained per the Patreon. I followed the advice of our lovely Patreons who know way more about FPL than I do, and they said to triple captain, so we're triple captaining KDB for the SAS robots this week.
Oh, well, that's not gone well to start with.
I mean, he did get a return.
Sorry, who was your triple captain?
Probably why my neck
FPL Ivory Tower of fucking it.
Yes, our triple captain Salah, which that was a fun game to watch on many levels for me.
Yeah, but you didn't capture him for the first fixture. It's the second fixture, mate. So
it's all about opportunity, isn't it?
Yeah, indeed. But 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I've got 9 fixtures to go, and I'm on 57 post-boner points.
Right, well played, mate.
I'll take that with no chips, baby.
Commiserations to all those who bench boosted with the fucking massacre it's been so far.
No, you're not bothering about that. Commiserations. No, fucking hilarious. Oh, I know what I'm going to do in the middle of a pandemic where every game is getting cancelled left, right, and centre. I'm going to spend every hour of every day thinking about my FBL team, planning for it, and then I'm going to spunk the biggest chip in the middle of it.
Well, you got to do it sometime. Is it
hashtag
ever
FPL,
better?
Hashtag PTS. Sorry if you don't want to hear it.
I fucking love a double game week, though. I can see why people get excited. Like, that's the only thing about FPL that I like is the double game weeks and the chips. Like, we have the stats robots have 13 players left to play.
Yeah, that's fun.
That's great. Fun. That's so exciting. Like, I'm actually in this week. This week, it's my team. Other weeks, it's everyone else's team. This week, it's my team.
Yeah, absolutely. That's fine.
So, good luck. Hope you don't all pull your hair out and stuff like that. And then we'll be back to record next Sunday.
It's too late for me to pull all my hair out. Exactly. He's making a bald joke. Yeah.
Oh, I'm not used to it because you've got such a luscious mane of hair that you've been growing for 6 months.
11 months and 4 days. Thank you kindly. 11 months and 4 days. This is by far the longest I've ever gone without a haircut.
Oh, no, I was talking about Ian, but yeah, that's taken about him 6 months. Yeah,
this is about the longest I can get to. This fucking fluff that I've got, this microphone hair that I've got here. Fucking hell.
Dare to dream, baby. Dare to dream.
I can trim my down belows with manscaped.com, discount code MOP20. So, you know.
There's the end of the Manscaped partnership. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for listening. Thanks to Michael Allen for joining us as a Patreon. Thanks to producer Nate Whittam, and we wish him all the best.
Soldier. Private Nate.
Private Nate. For your private parts, manscaped.com. Say goodbye, Oscar.
Goodbye.
Say goodbye, Ian.
Bye.
And it's bye from me. Take care. Ian, you don't need to rush me, mate. I nail it every time.